the question is about knowing that intellectual trajectory. The development of your ideas, the main influence on them, your own interests, and the forces that shape those ideas. It's a long question, but if you could.
It's very excellent one. An Italian living in the 50s, and in a special situation it was after the war, with a shift, complete shift of intellectual orientations, from fascist and mainly idealistic framework of Italian culture, we moved to a mainly Marxist ideology, and with a great influence of the Communist Party, and with a large movement of ideas and extremely complex and conflictual transformation of the country. That was at the end of the 40s and the beginning of the 50s. When I moved to the University of Florence from my city, which is the same city of Fellini, Fellini is close from my mother, I arrived in Florence and I studied in a university in which the ideological contrast between left and wing in the end right was very strong. And I was really impressed by the idea that I heard in the end of my studies of the possibility of materialistic gnoseology, if I can resume that. And if I give a bizarre explanation, I would say that for me, just after I finished my university studies, what was really important, it was the possibility of articulation between what we call in this period superstructure and infrastructure, the idea of the material condition of life and the superstructure, the cultural and ideological representation. This is the reason, because I was so impressed during the beginning of the 60s by Lévi-Strauss and structuralism, that kind of analysis offered apparently the possibility of articulation between infrastructure and superstructure, between the material conditions of knowledge and the form of knowledge, without reducing one to another, a sort of articulation of idealistic and materialistic point of view. When I met Barthes in Paris and Goldman, because I was a student of Barthes, student of Goldman at the same time, Christian Goldman was highly impressed by Lukács in his sociology and literature, and Barthes was, we have to say that now, because everyone forgot that, was very impressed by Brecht. He was a student, a scholar, studying Brecht theater. And in this period, I was very impressed with his work. I translated in Italian and made a lot of work of Goldman and Barthes. But gradually, the work with Barthes was very bizarre, because Barthes is a sort of extraordinary, a great esprit de finesse, and probably not this kind of man. And I moved on Barthes' suggestion to work with Gramsci. Gramsci was giving in this period his work about semantics, structure and semantics, and he was in the same time extremely close to people as Goldman. Goldman died, unfortunately, in this period, and he was no more influenced by the Lukács framework. I remember as a sort of crucial moment for me when I was in Paris with a grant of the Italian government when I finished university, that I met in Goldman course congratulated. And he was very young, there's a difference of 7 years between us, but we spent all our life together. He says sometimes that we have lunch more than with our respective wives. And I was impressed by it for being in mind. And when I went back from Paris to Italy, Florence, we worked together for a long time. But coming back to Paris, I was impressed in this period by the great quantity of work. I didn't meet Foucault in this period, but I know that people are working with him, and I have a lot of contact with young people working with Foucault, and I follow without pleasure a lot of Lacan courses. I remember that he asked me once, why you are following this course? Because I'm linguist and I'm interested in myself, the way we are transforming linguistic paradigm. Well, I continue to work with Fermat, with a strong influence on my framework, which was social sciences, human sciences, we say, which is large in in France, and in Italy, social science is a human background. You deserve knowledge in philosophy and in literature. Well, this is for distinction, because it seems very important. Well, when I went back to Italy, and having a strong formation in my opinion in semiotics and Remas, and in social and human sciences, I met Beko in Florence. He was assistant to a university in sociology, and Beko says, well, stop to do that and come with me. I will give lectures in aesthetics in the architectural department. I followed him, and we worked a lot about aesthetics for a long time, until he moved to Milan, and I moved to, as a social professor, to Urbino. Urbino was a very, and he is a very pleasant and a little city. There are 8,000 students and 8,000 inhabitants, one to one. And if you go to see a movie, well, you have the impression that you are in a city, but in some time you are with friends and students. Well, the situation was very good because it's an excellent university in which there is a private university, which is rare in Italy. There are just two, the Catholic University and the Urban University. You have plenty of possibility to do what you want. And I convinced two friends of mine, Professor Carnabò, an old and absolutely boring Catholic absolutely Catholic writer, and an exceptional personality, Professor Paglioni, older than me, but younger from the spiritual point of view, and to build up this Centro Semiotico Linguistico di Urbino. And we worked for a long time in this center, and we invited people from everywhere, and for 4 or 5 years, we worked so seriously, and we developed really a network of people, of research, of ideas, and we must come back from Paris and stay for a long time, you know. And we organized a good center, which a lot of scholars and that and so on, work together for a very good period. May I add, for the sake of the personalization, I was very in love with a so beautiful woman that we never leave the place also. But fortunately, for my future career, she lives with men largely better than I am, and this is the reason it helped me to move for the in the middle of 70s. In the middle of 70, I spent some time in California, San Diego, as a visiting professor. And I was in touch with the American culture. And I was impressed by the way in which, at the same time, my framework of formation, structuralism, Marxism, and psychoanalysis, and so on, was translated in a very different way. I worked very closely with Professor James. I was impressed by the way in which he translated everything. It was not, I didn't agree all the time. And possibly my relation with James was not more brilliant in this one. But anyway, I was very impressed by the capacity, of vital capacity of American culture to translate and to assume. But sometimes I was impressed also by the way in which they fast pass from a paradigm to another one. For example, I was in Brunel and they gave a lecture about Lacan, and I expressed some doubts about the way in which the paradigmatic concept of psychoanalysis were mixed with a certain kind of linguistics. And I said, well, that semiotics, for example, could be very useful for thinking about the language more than the usual paradigmatic feature of psychoanalysis, in which language is just a collection of words and metaphors. And, well, large part of the students left my course. Immediately they stand up and they left. I was surprised because it would be never the Italian or the French way of discussing this, in a way we don't need faith from this point of view. Well, I was impressed in this point. I went back in Europe in 1977, and I was called by ECO, the Institute of Communication in Bologna. I was an associate professor there for a long time. During this period, I met and I worked very closely with Italo Calvino. There is a reason for that, and you can find the reason described in the post-fair class of the Castle of Cross and Destiny, the book Calvino. Calvino used tarots for combining the book, and he inspired and he quoted Calvino to a lecture I gave in Vino about the language of emblems and tarots, narrative combinations. Well, from this very period, I was very in touch with him. He was so interested in structural analysis of narrative and so on. You find a lot of indication in his work. And he lives in Paris. And I come back practically all the time. Paris from Bologna is very close, you know, so just extremely close, some hours of train. I continue to be in touch with Mas and with another group and with Calvino. And during this time, the two things during my work in the semiotics happened. The first was the, in the same period, the terrorism in Italy, in the end of the 70s and the beginning of the 80s. And the second one was an earthquake in our call in university life was the name of the rose written by the president. Well, the two events are very always important from the theoretical point of view, I insist, theoretical, not just political. I spent so much time giving exams to my students in jail or somewhere another place that I was so intimately touched by these events in which you have people, friends killed and wounded and in prison or in exile and so on and so on. That this little event, which is finally so far now, touched me so much that I decided that it was not possible that what we do in semiotics was unusual for that. The idea that I have political engagement and another part come back at home and work on your formal plans was unbearable for me. And for Eco too, Eco began to write the name of the rose after the murder of the Aldo Moro, the chief of the government. Well, come back to my work. Well, I decided to open a new space for my semantics, not just this formal description, but to take into account three points, and 3 points that I continued to work on. The first one was the idea of semiotics as a sort of gnosiology, you know, a theory of knowledge, epistemological tools, with inference, narrative, structure, and so on. But the idea that you use science in a very complex way, for example, for falsification and for secret. And the fact that you are not interested in evidence of science, not only falsification and secret, seems to me so important in this period that I work in a seminar about falsification, which was taken by the Italian police as a sort of subversive seminar, and which is exactly the contrary. I will try to persuade my students that the idea that you take a gun and kill was absolutely ridiculous. And then the complexity of modern society, capitalistic society, so on, was so great that the first thing we have to do is to know this complexity and to work inside this complexity. Not for this society against. This is another problem. The problem is to know the mechanism. Well, the second move of my work was on the problem of war. And I say war in a very minimal sense, as a strategy. We use science as a sort of epistemological tool for knowing truth and so on. But what is going on during the strategic moment? The first victim is the truth. When you have an attack in this period, for example, the police, sometime, you have a message from the librarians, and the police has to know if it's real from them, because possibly it's a rightist group making the attack and using the name of the librarians. Or possibly it was the police that do the same for provocation and so on, because they try to make an infiltration inside the group. Anyway, immediately in the conflict, the truth disappeared. And my idea was, what you are not taking enough in account the strategic dimension and the conflict dimension inside the knowledge of science knowledge. I work a lot on that. And the last problem was the problem in which I was giving. I give my lectures here too now. And I began in the early 80s to think that there is no reason to teach something. There is no reason to pass your knowledge if you don't like in some way, in a passionate way, what you do. I know that is a very rhetorical picture. But I try to transform this topos in this commonplace in a tool of knowledge. And I began to work on passions. I decided that we spent so long time speaking about knowledge and gnosiology that we need to speak about passion, the form of passion, the organization of passion. We have to inscribe these concepts inside the field. If I was not able to do it, I would abandon. You know, my brother is the director of three of most large nightclubs of Italy, especially on the Adriatic coast. And it's not difficult to find another work, but a job would be very easy. But the challenge is a good challenge, and I think I'm doing a good work. And I'm not proud of that, but I'm sure that I'm doing good. Well, passions, falsification, simulacra, and strategy. Firstly, I was obliged to meet other kind of person. And in this period, I began to work with a group of people in the periodical of Beaubourg in France, and is Traverse. Traverse was a bizarre periodical. In the board, editorial board, there are Jean Baudrillard, Paul Mérignot, Marc Guillaume, and other people, and Louis Morin, and me. And we worked together for years, and we abandoned recently the periodical for political for the change of direction, for the world, so on, so on. This is really important. What we did in this period is to try to, I try to work in semiotics from a very formal point of view, at the same time to work on a more culture-oriented, domain. Well, I for a long time I tried to work about things I really like, for example, politics and secret codes. I wrote an article about double engines because they are at the same time question of classification and strategy and so on. So the other problem in this period, I said in the beginning, there are also the eco movement towards narrative. It was a very important moment for us because eco moved because of the enormous success of the novel, absolutely unexpected success from eco. It is a very direct person. I mean, I never built up something for success. He did what he knows. And the enormous talent he has, incredible talent he has, capacity of work, he had the success he deserves. But something changed completely in semiotic orientation in Italy. I will quote just a detail for emphasizing the shift. In the Name of the Rose, there's a character. The name of this character is Paolo Darini. My name is Paolo, I am from Rome. And called Abbas Agraficus, saying that I don't write a lot, this is true. And second, that this character is the scholar of the student of a scholar, the name is Algernas. The Cluny, Dr. Cornelius. Algernas is the name of Professor Thomas, working in semiotics, and Dr. Quadratus because of the semiotic square is supposed to be invented by the Romans and so on. Yeah, this is the story. The character is supposed in the novel of Umberto Eco to organize the great library, the library in which birds and animals and so on and so on. But I don't participate in that. I leave and apparently am killed by thieves or lions, I don't know. Well, it's a good metaphor. In this period we split radically. I continue to look at semiotics as an instrument of political engagement of knowledge of society, very close to my origin of social and human scientists, with Kant, right? And Eco turned radically to a new character with his enormous capacity of change. And he began more and more to be close to, not to European tradition, but to American tradition, working closely with Putnam and Peirce and so on, and mainly in philosophical direction. The idea of the Eco now is to split semiotics in pure semiotics and applied semiotics. Pure semiotics is philosophy of language. And applied semiotics is people with dirty hands, working in cinema, literature, and so on and so on. I don't agree with it. In my opinion, is a great mistake. But there's another problem. It was moving to be more and more what it was in the beginning. From the first beginning, before to Lardier, to the paradigm of the semiotics, a philosopher, an aesthetician. Well, Now we are working together, but in different directions. I left Bologna, I went to Palermo for professor. I continued to philosophy language. And I continue to work in Paris. In Paris, I work in the, paradoxically, I work in the Collège International de Philosophie, as an institution of the Department, National Department of Research, and I am director of the program. The Collège International de Philosophie is founded by Derrida, and one of the directors was a close friend of mine, is Jean-François Lyotard. I was very close to Lyotard. I've met him in the United States, in San Diego. And if you look in his book about Dick Ferrand, we discovered that when you have the older books in the bibliography, you can find power of other personal communication. Well, why I quote all the time other people, not me, speak about me? For two reasons. One is the necessity of academic modesty. And the second is the fact that, in my opinion, when you have to speak about you in your work, the coherence of what you say is inside what you say, your personality. But there is a strong necessity to think to yourself in what about said once, certain time. Said well, my preferred tree is palm. Why palm? It's because other trees arise and palms fall down. the idea that sometimes is amusing that you succeed your friends better you succeed yourself is what a good professor and have to do.
Now, let's go on to the next question. I could be slightly sort of
relevant. Yeah, you can.
This one is mainly a theoretical question.
I'm waiting for that.
Yes.
I spoke very anecdotically about other questions.
Well, let's have the definition of semiotics, and then, if possible, link it up with structuralism, post-structuralism, and deconstruction. Then that way you could talk about the whole development of an intellectual tradition.
Yeah. Well, I will be brief, because this kind of definition are certain kind of texts. For example, Guémas and Cortés wrote an excellent dictionary about semiotics, and you have a definition of semiotics. I will use the question for making a distinction, saying what a semiotic is not, and after that, what semiotic is. What is not? Semiotics is not the study of science. Well, in the same way in which linguistics is not the study of words. But linguistics is the study of the way in which we speak. And semiotics is an attempt to study forms, organization, and process of signification. The way in which we organize and the way in which we process the signification. The difference is crucial because the size, for example, the object is crucially different. Yeah? Just look in science. The same way in which you look at words. You look at the sentences, you look at texts in linguistics, and you do the same. You don't, in my opinion, there is no sign, for example, in paintings, but there are forms and processes of signification in paintings. I'm persuaded that what is a musical sign? I don't know. If you try to cut the music some signs, you'll never succeed. But process of signification, in my opinion, very crucial. And why I start from the general process of signification and not from science? There are two fundamental reasons. There are theoretical two, but very practical two. Suppose that we have different kinds of words and you put words together. Are you producing a text? Not at all. The fact that you produce text You know what we mean, but we don't know how we mean what we mean. What semiotic is trying to do is to add some level of intelligibility to the fact that we mean, already mean. How you know what we know? This is the problem of semiotics. How you feel what you feel? Not the idea to collect science, meaning of science, and to put that together. We never saw the question. You remember my story? What about your book? And the answer is, I have all the words. But I have just to put them together. If you know all the science of the world, then you have the book, then nothing. Well, this is, from my point of view, this is the crucial difference between two synthetic and analytic traditions. People starting from units, they hope that they will produce meaning by accumulation or integration of units. People starting from a phenomenological point of view, and we start from this phenomenological point of view. I say phenomenological in large sense, not in the sense of tradition or usages, Pierre-Conti and so on. We start from general level of signification, and we try to apply models in this general model of signification, and at the same time to disimply from the text new models. I say all the time that we don't apply semiotics, pure semiotics, to the text. The idea is to disimply from text models useful to refigurate your concepts, to restructure your concepts. They are so different, two different models. First, second, when you think about science, the problem of comparison is very crucial. For example, it's almost easy to compare linguistic science. Not so easy to compare. But how can you compare linguistic science to visual science, to auditory science, to tactile science? Well, if you distinguish science using the substance of the expression, visual substance, what we call modalities, senses, well, you can do an excellent work, but what about that when you speak really, and when you speak you use intonation, you use gestures, you use position of body, and so on. What you will say about cinema, or movie, what you will say about opera, dancing, in which you have everything, colors, music, movements, language, and so on. You will never succeed to put all the codes together and produce the general sense. You have to work in opposite sides. This is the reason, because you are more interested, for example, in analyzing form of text and try to discover if there are common features which are common but not necessarily commensurable between different kinds of sense. For example, a very simple aspect. In language, you have means for pointing things. So, I, you, here, after, before, and so on. You just should. Well, but you have the same in paintings. In paintings, you have different kinds of strategies that point on what is really important in painting. You have to look particularly there and not there. If you look in the Renaissance painting, you will discover a lot of fingers. All the characters point to the finger, and you have to follow the finger and to look at what is going on there. Sure, what is going on is also a thing. But you know, the foolish man, when you show the sun and the moon, look at the finger. You have not just to look at the finger. Well, for example, this is a feature which is a common feature. There is no commensurability between image and words, but there are common formal categories permitting you to make translations, which are not reductions. And this is the reason that I think actual semiotics we are doing now, is possibly interesting.
Okay. The next question is a little follow-up to that. Can you sort of give us the perhaps a broad intellectual history of the development of post-structuralism and deconstruction and the relationship to semiotics?
know, it's uneasy to explain the structuralist attitude. It's possible to say that formalism, Russian formalism, influence from natural sciences, development of logic, and so on and so on, have an enormous importance in this kind of. But I can say that structuralism, for me, is starting from the crucial linguistic idea, which is very new. It's just the end of the century, the beginning of the century. How is it possible to give a formal or formalized or organized description of meaning? This is very hard, and it's not so old as the 90 years. Well, structuralism as a movement was really important for me. I tried to say that before, because of the great impact in transforming the idealistic and the materialistic opposition. I had the impression that we found there an organized way to speak about meaning and to make correct comparison between formal text and material condition of life. It was my own utopia. But structuralism is more than that. It is in the same time a strategy of reasoning and mainly a movement, an intellectual movement. Well, if you look from now, you know that we can never make the history except from now. And what would be better to say that we never can go back to history if you have no preoccupation for the future. In fact, we go from the future to the past and we come back to the past. Well, our future preoccupation, which is the present, is now, permits now to come back to the present, to the past in a certain way. First, the idea that intentional subjectivity was not so important, and that there are structural conditions for the appearance of the subjectivity. This is what is extremely clear in Foucault's first work. The second is that the meaning is not in itself. The meaning is understandable minimally by opposition. I don't know what is like if I don't know what is like. And the idea that the intelligibility is made by relations and not by inner qualities of the object. You have to establish relation. The true object of structuralism was the relation between elements. And evidently, the full subjectivity, the intentionality philosophy, you can find also Rousseau, dissolves from a certain point of view. Well, there are also a lot of ideological philosophy grasping this paradigm and speaking and saying a lot of things. I don't care. I don't care now, and I didn't care in spirit about the logical attempts to transform structuralism in a philosophy of history, or structuralism as a tool for describing the phenomenology of materialistic knowledge. Now the problem is what the structuralism was as a strategy of intelligibility of the world. In my opinion, without knowing the linguistic tradition, the Levi-Strauss work on anthropology, and Merleau-Ponty redefinition of the phenomenological condition, we have not clear idea of what structuralism was. And I'm not persuaded by a lot of the structuralist. If you ask me what was the quality of structuralism, I would say that it's not just the organization word, sort of metalinguistic capacity, create a relationship and so on. So on. Was the as a, I think of to structuralism as a procedure of discovery. In the idea of structure, there is always the idea when you apply a structure, for example, to some subject matter, the idea that you will find something which is apparently inexistent without application of the structure. The structure reveals an empty place. Do you remember the idea of the gray zero degree of the zero degree of writing, the senior zero in Jacobson, and so on and so on. I think to structure as a procedure, not as a philosophy, but a procedure in scale. This is the reason because I stand on this position again, and I'm not part of structures, and I'm not the constructions. At least, if the construction is a strategy, and it is, to make this kind of procedure description and of discovery, I think it is, I am the constructions, and I am a post-structuralist. Well, when you think today to post-structuralist, in my opinion, you can think in a different point of view. One is from outside, looking at a sort of a movement of a theoretical and philosophical framework today. And from this point of view, what is absolutely clear, and that concept is postmodern, so on, are very important. Well, my friend Lyotard said time ago that post-modernism is not just post in the temporal order, and then Montaigne is a post-modern person. You know, the idea is that not that the difference between the modernism and post-modernism is not in time, but in conceptual organization. And from this point of view, I think that post-structuralism is not in the time, is in the past too. I think Remus is post-structuralist, but in the sense that the work of Remus transformed the conditions of its own old structures, and now he is post-structuralist, but not because we are in a new time or we changed the paradigmatic feature and so on, because he was able to transform the model and to inscribe some claim that was opposed to structural paradigm. First, for example, the role of the passion. Second, the role of the pleasure, the plaisir of the text, for example. Fragment du discours en Europe, fragment of modern discourse. Well, the necessity of inscription of the subjectivity in a new form. Subjectivity was evacuated by structuralism, but after the Modernist, and in the new semiotic approach, the subject of enunciation is a crucial feature of the model. This is the problem we agree completely. But at the same time, what seems to me, independently from this kind of distinction, what is common, not what is different, is the approach of the language, the linguistic term, which is common to this kind of problem. And this linguistic term is absolutely crucial for all these disciplines. I will make no difference but convergences. And I will explain the reason. Anytime. Italian is a dead language, the sense that is spoken just for the people in the other country. Remember. And I am interested all the time to dictionaries. In the dictionary, you will never find expression which are exactly the same in both languages. And there is a lot of expression. And when you go in your language, you are surprised all the time. You say, oh yes, it seems so, the idiom seems to me so bizarre, and we have the same meaning. Well, what is the reason? It's very simple. If you have a dictionary, what What is the reason for having a dictionary if you translate the same idioms, a dictionary's interest, only and only if you have discrepancies? This is the reason because the dictionary apparently is made for translation, but in reality is an accentuation of the difference. Well, let me try to do as in German the attempts to emphasize the common qualities. The common qualities of structural tradition and post-modern tradition and the construction tradition is the emphasis on language and on hermeneutics. I will try to be clear in this profound part of it. So this is a nice metaphor. In the metaphor of a house the house you have in the country villa, and city. When you think very deeply in your country house, there is no possibility for transmitting the experience. For transmitting the experience is necessary to urbanize the house of being. Very clearly, to build bridge, to make roads, and so on. What is the reason? It's because for transmitting experience, you need language. This is the reason because the philosophy points too much the problematic of the subject and can solve the problem of intersubjectivity. There is only way for us to solve the question, how can I understand really that you understand now what I understand, and that I understand, you understand, so on and so on. This is the only way, the fact I speak language. Language is the only way in which you can at the same time think in a very radical new way, and at the same time in a communicative way. This is the reason because all this movement has the language as a crucial feature. Second feature is the problem of the hermeneutic circle. You can split explanation and interpretation. You can have a good interpretation of something and explanation, a good explanation, but sometimes explanation are not good interpretation. And sometimes they are good interpretation about explanation. Well, what is the possibility in human sciences? And I am very touched by human science, history, anthropology, and so on and so on. In this one, it's very simple. Your explanation transforms the condition of what you are explaining. It's not exactly in a certain kind of natural sciences. In human sciences, every explanation is a new text transforming what you have to explain. This is what we call circle and reflexivity of explanation. In my opinion, we have to stand in the circle, but to find the good way to enter in the circle. No? This is my point. You can say we have no need for explanation. You can understand the world without explaining the world, in my opinion. But if you enter in the game, explaining the world, you have to accept anyway this fundamental feature of your experience. You transform constantly what you are studying by the fact that you are studying. This is the reason because, again, the metaphor of text is so unique. When you analyze a text, you transform the condition of the text. Because, you know, a language is not, again, I come back to the experience of time, I'm forced to speak another kind of language most of the time, is this one. Language is not a complete system. This is the reason that when you translate a language in another one, you are not just transferring an element in a closed box to an element in another closed box, but you are in a certain way completing, remunerating what is not in both languages. This is the experience of knowing as increasing the knowledge, or just knowledge, and in the same time, knowing as a continuous activity of translation. Well, this is the challenge. Is structuralism, constructionism, post-structuralism able to answer this question? This is the problem.
Well, is well then, how far has each discipline has approached the center of that problem?
Now I have to describe the mistake and the advantage. That would be
too.
Now, I like the idea to say, but we have a common problem, and the problem is that some kind of
problem. That it's probably better, rather than going in the whole
like this question.
I have other questions, but we've taken up so much time now. Is there anything that you want to add to this?
Probably that would be amusing to speak about the experience of Monsieur Dorsay.
Okay, of course, yes. I know that you've had a role in the museum, or say in the organization of the museum.
But I like to speak about this discussion because, you know, as all the Italian intellectuals, we suppose, probably rightly, that university work is not enough. And you have to be closely engaged to different kind of intellectual organization. The idea of Turis Tribunia, Ivory Tower, which major book in the paranoid way and so on, is not yet penetrated the academic Italian process. They will be in Israel, this is general life. But until now, we are pleased to do different kind of things. For example, 5 years ago, I had two museum experiences. The first one was this one. The Cultural Institute of Italy was trying to organize a lot of information about Italy in France. French people have a bizarre idea with Italians, and not just people with mustaches and gondolas and so on. They are not tourists. Not just people with a coppola and gun. They have reactions. But they think that Italy doesn't exist. But they like Siena, Florence, Venice, and so on. For them, Italy is not a state, but it's a federation of cities. And they are. Absolutely. I think so. Italian think of themselves as federation of cities. In Toronto is Italian city, from the view. It is exactly the same way in which Palermo is not an Italian city. Well, this idea is an amusing one. And the city of Trieste organized a lot of huge exposition in Beaubourg, on the Tour Eiffel, inside the beautiful movie. The round form of the cinema of the Museum of La Villette and so on. And I was one of the directors of this activity. And it was a very amazing experience, very, very amazing experience. We built up a beautiful white sheep inside the Beaubourg form and so on. And I was extremely pleased to do it. Well, this was great. And the second one, this one. Guy Olivetti, the famous woman architect, is probably one of the best architects now in Europe, was charged to reconstruct the Musée d'Orsay. It was an ancient train station. And well, they tried to transform that in a museum. It's absolutely amazing. It's absolutely easy because, you know, the dream of a curator is a corridor. A corridor in which you find every time, years, 81, 82, 83, and so on. And the Gare d'Orsay, the museum, is an extremely large place in which it's not possible to create corridors. And the idea was how you can manage to construct a space in which you can move, and at the same time, the pertinence of historical trajectory is pertinent, but at the same time, how can you manage the fact that you cannot leave constantly the trajectory and to have a different kind of experience? And with Madame Ardenti, with the director of the Louvre, with the curator of the museum, we form an extremely aggressive and nasty group of people, aggressive and nasty each other, for almost 1 year, in which we find a group I don't like, and the name was a group of semantic and communication, so on. And it was an extremely interesting experience for understanding what an aesthetic experience is, what a museum is, what is a system of science. We design also the science for going to the toilet. Well, it was a passionate experience, and I hope once we spend some time to write something about that, to bring it up.
Mm-hmm. I have one more question that sort of concerns me. What a lot of senior objects that you have, the concern with the organization of science, and oftentimes what you have to do is really to break it down into some kind of constituent element as well, in order to get a sense of the organization. But if we take the kind of a Gestalt approach to it, then it never adds up to the sum of its parts, if you add up to text or a picture or what have you. So inevitably, perhaps that kind of an approach is doomed to failure, but perhaps that's not interesting. What's important is to figure out what additional work the semiotician has to do in order to complete the analysis, because if you use a kind of a semiotic approach, perhaps you never get to the totality of that.
No, sure. But this is the problem of the hermeneutic circle. There is no totality you can join. But at the same time, there is a constant transformation. This is the reason because I like so much the artistic or poetic text. Because coming back to the artistic text, you find always more than the memory of what is described in the text itself. Sure, the hermeneutic work is an endless work. There's no possibility of totality. But in the same time, I tried to say that before, that you complete, when you say complete, is I say that you is you're open ending the text, and you complete the text by interpretation. They assume that every interpretation is an execution, in the sense you execute music, or you transform a script in a movie, or in a theater. Everything is always different. The idea that the text is a system, a closed system of sign, is not the way. At the same time, what is true, and probably here I have to respond to your question about I escaped for the time about the construction. It's true that the text is not just an endless possibility of interpretation. You can see everything. If you can see everything, you can see nothing. If you can say everything, you can see nothing. It's exactly the same. And the problem is the problem for me, but it's problem also for other people. Look at Eco's nasty polemics against the constructions. Eco has the same problem. For example, he starts from the idea of opera. Open work. You can give any interpretation of an open work. Well, suppose that it is in this way. You can do it everything, changing time, changing your habits, and so on. Why not? Unfortunately, you discover very fast that it's not that the opera, the text, construct some interpretation. For example, people in the United States are very attentive to the idea of purse of infinite interpretation of science. A sign points to another sign, it's interpreted by another sign, so on and so on and so on. This is a crucial question. But at the same time, if everything is possible to say, but there's, you don't need inspiration, you don't need semantics, you just say. How is it possible, at the same time, to keep in touch with the structure of the text, and at the same time, to the not infinite, but the open point interpretation? This is the challenge. Eco accused, for example, people in accused people in the working in Derrida direction that they can say everything. But in the same time, he used also the idea of infinite interpretation and open work. This is a difficult contradiction for him, and he's standing in a very difficult way. But I think we are all the same problem, how it's possible at the same time to discover not the rules, the concept too strong, but the constraints, the strictures of a certain kind of organization of text, at the same time to keep in touch with the open part of the interpretation. But I think this is the, what I called some ago. The idea of entering in the hermeneutic circle with the good foot, you know, in the right moment. This is not a problem that you can solve in an ontological way, in a transcendental future. You have to, it's a decision you have to take, it's an approach you have to choose, and semiotics is not a political system, in my opinion. It's a very open-ended work. I say open-ended, and I think that the problem is the image I have of semiotics is really door, open-ended, you know? At the same time, instrument of closing, instrument of opening, instrument of communication, and the stopping communication. When you have, you know, when you are inside about a paradigm in research, and someone makes a very acute remark, the fact that the remark is acute is not enough. Because we have to translate the remarks in a pertinent concept that are coherent to what you are doing. Without that, you change fashions. You say, well, no more fashions. Or say, you're no more acute. No more Foucault, no more Derrida. And you can do it, no more Eco, no more Jacobson, no more Grimaud. But I'm not sure that is a good way to do it. I don't like the supermarket approach. My idea is that when we have to be attentive, when an acute remark, when a strong proposition is made, to think what kind of ticket of invitation you can send in your written in your language to the new concept for the translation of the concept in your own problems, for transforming your paradigm. It's not just the idea to add a new entry in your bibliography or make a dramatic Christian conversion in the St. Paul style, you know, falling from the horse and immersed in new light or paradigm. I don't believe it. From this point of view, I'm really echoing always this gesture for me. The idea that I follow always the same line.
There's one final question, perhaps, and that has to be with ideology and the way that ideology is inscribed in these texts. How do you begin to kind of tackle that issue and perhaps disengage later on, or even can disengage later on from a text and identify supposedly ideology would also arrange the text in particular?
This is a very crucial problem because, you know, the success of semiotics was a false promise. And probably semiotics is a victim of this false promise, is the idea to be a science of the knowledge. It was very clearly said by Barthes in the early 60s, in the end of 50s, in the Brazilian culture as well. The Bach was a Brechtian. His fundamental feature is the idea of disdain the world, which is absolutely a Brechtian idea. The idea of Bach was this one. If you find a discipline, not necessarily science, able to make a friction on the ideological text in which the bourgeois thinking in the same time display and conceal the his own ideology, well, this discipline of the science will be the new discipline of the science. That was for the reason of the success also in this period. A sort of science of able to discover the debris in all things, a sort of a new truth, erasing the ideological work. This also was from in this period, before I come, the reason because Marcuse and other people thought about psychoanalysis as a sort of a treatment which are able to inverse the distortion of censorship on desire. Well, re-establishing the good relationship between the good object and the desire. Well, we work very serious hypothesis, and I assure you, not just for the intellectual point of view, also in this period with the political forces which are supposed to go in this direction. And the crisis of this hypothesis is a crisis not only of internal crisis, but also the crisis of this hope, of this project, which was also a social, political project, not just another product in the university supermarket. Well, from a point of view, the crisis of the socialist project, I have not explained. And from another point of view, the idea that truth, zero degree, is never been achieved, will never be achieved. And what you are managing are discursive formations, I'm speaking Foucault in terms. And you have to just to manage discursive formation without possibility to decide that there is an outside as sex, economy, I don't know, permitting you an exterior position from which you look at the reality, you look at the text. As a good intelligent professor, left-wing, open mind, and so on, you look at the text, you make you open the mail, and you show that the true ideology of the text itself. Name a what position? What's your position? This was 68th question. And during the 70s, the crisis was really this problem. In Scandinavian mind. The crisis was there is no more scientific Marxism, economic, sexual condition which permits to a value-free group or a group speaking the name of the party to say this is that, this is the object of the text. We will extract the ideology, we will destroy the ideology, and we will re-establish the grace of the text. We are inside, and we have to do is the calculus of this complexity. I have finished with quite a beautiful image of my friend Calvino. Calvino said, well, we are all prisoners inside the Chateau d'If. You remember the story of Count of Monte Cristo. You are inside, and you make calculus. We need also to, we want to escape. But the problem of escaping is a problem of confidence. But you are part of the fortress too. And this reflexive condition, hermeneutic condition, is the condition you have to accept and in which you have to work for transforming this condition. There is no more instance from outside the history for judging the history and deciding that this is the object and this is not. This is the reason, because I have to work on text, but without hope of definite theological judgment of the text. I know it's a pity. I know that means we have no more than dry dreams from the 60s and 70s, but also the necessity to accept that there is not just intellectual relationship to professors and texts, but a moving world in which we have to accept some terrific and terrifying lesson from history.